Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Kamal Janarthan. At the end of this presentation, I'd like to meet with whoever of you can pronounce my last name from looking at the slide. I'm a lead program manager in the Exchange team, and the areas that I own is, for E14, one of them, or the major investments that we're making, is archiving, retention, and discovery. So before I get started, I'd like to ask a question of the folks in the room. How many folks think PSTs are the best invention that ever came out of Microsoft and should never go away? Great. Thank you. Thank you. A show of hands for these brave folks, please. So in a nutshell, when we were looking at archiving and retention and kind of the reason to do this, it came from the first primary early charge of feedback, which was, we hate PSTs. You created PSTs, and when I was kind of making this presentation to a customer the other day, they said, well, this is familiar. You create a problem, and then you release something that solves it. So guilty as charged in this particular case. And if you kind of look at the story of email, originally, when we didn't have the kind of email inflow that we do today, you kept your data in your mailbox, and you were fine. You didn't have a problem. As email inflow increased, end users found a requirement to have access to and keep larger amounts of data, but the mailbox didn't necessarily support it. And so you had PSTs, where end users could keep them on their desktop and on very cheap storage and have access to this information. But then as time passed further, email volume continued to grow, PST corruption, data limits became a problem, the data wasn't backed up in a PST, and finally, there came the point, particularly in the U.S., of regulation in 2002 when FRCP or eDiscovery laws were passed, and there were sort of equivalent but less stringent laws across the world. And this meant that whatever email you have, if it exists in your environment, it has to be retrievable. Additional to end users wanting access to all this data, IT pros now had to also control it, so they couldn't just leave this data in an unmanaged environment. So one of the first questions as we looked at this archiving problem and heard your feedback on the pain points is, where in the world is your email today? What are all the repositories in which it's bled into, and what are the reasons why it goes to those repositories, reasonable or undesirable? So we found that data kind of moves out of Exchange, first of all, into PSTs. You put it in backups to enable a disaster recovery or single item recovery. In fact, backups are sort of the Swiss Army knife of the Exchange environment. They're used for any number of things. And one of the things we're looking at is, can we solve some of those problems without the overhead and cost of backups? Additionally, end users start forwarding mail out of their inbox. Their mailboxes aren't large enough. They have the notion of consumer mail, where the mailboxes are infinite. And so they forward or release the data, which results in information disclosure for the org. And finally, kind of one of the sort of largest points of interest to us is this data gets moved into third-party archives. So third-party archives are deployed, the feedback we've gotten, for two reasons. One is storage management. I can't keep all my data in Exchange. And second is compliance requirements. I need to ensure that I can discover the data, apply retention policy on it, et cetera. Well, we know how to store the data. And moving or syncing this data outside of Exchange results in certain architectural difficulties or end-user pain points. I'm going to talk about those more in a moment. So when we went and did a survey of customers as to where this data lives in your enterprise, these are the four sort of data places that live outside of Exchange due to requirements that Exchange cannot fulfill. The Exchange mailbox, mail is in it, but it can't grow to the size that customers actually need. PSTs, good for end users, it's very cheap, absolutely no compliance capability. The personal archive is an end user archive. It's sort of your extended mailbox. However, the data is stored differently from the way it is in your primary mailbox. So the end user experience you get is segmented. And I'll drill into what are some of the pain points that we've heard from you on this. And finally, there's the org archive, which is just an archive maintained, which there is no end user access to, which may only be accessed by a records manager or an officer. Today, org archives are remarkably kind of used in a lot of environments by backups. So how many folks, instead of having any kind of org archive, I'm curious, just use backups as a way to maintain indefinite amounts of data for an infinite period of time? Could I see a wow. Okay, that's, and I think I would love to hear from you the ease of actually retrieving that data from the backup and then presenting it to the court, and then the fines that you get charged, because you can now get charged if you don't retrieve the data immediately, and you have to pay a lawyer to say, oh no, it's actually difficult to retrieve the data. So these are not desirable, and these are kind of some of the pain points we're seeing. So sort of a laundry list of pain points that we looked at. From an end user perspective, the end user wants one thing. We want an infinite mailbox, an infinite inbox. I don't have to think about deleting mail. I don't want to actually have to manage it. From the IT pro perspective, that is a nightmare. You have to manage storage costs for this mail. You have to make it discoverable. You have to ensure that there's retention policy or hold policies applied on this mail. When we talk to end users about how they use their PSTs, they're more or less okay with it, but it isn't the most reliable form of storage. It's on your desktop, and it's not backed up at all. And how many folks have PSTs on network shares? It's great. And as all of you know, that is a supported way to back up PSTs, yes? No, I'm being facetious. So that's unfortunate. We gave you this mechanism to store the data, but there is no way or functionality to ensure that it's backed up or highly available and reliable, and that's another problem that we've heard a great deal of feedback on. So you move this data out of, say, your mailbox and your PSD now into your personal archive. Is the end user's experience ideal? Well, the feedback we've gotten from end users is no. The data is in a completely different storage format and a different schema. And by definition, what you're going to get is a different user model. So when I try to access, say, a new feature in Exchange, like Conversation View, if it's off in a completely different storage paradigm, a different object model, I'm not going to get Conversation View on that data. So what we see is this splitting apart or segmenting of data, the syncing and moving of data out of Exchange, results in a broken end user experience. From the IT pro perspective, and really a lot of these features like the archive are deployed so the IT pro can fulfill that 6 p.m. requirement to discover all the mails between 2007 and 2008 with this keyword in it. From the IT pro perspective, the mailbox fulfills their requirements to some degree, but it's not large enough. It doesn't scale. PSTs are cheap, but if you ever have to discover them, it's a nightmare. So the same customer that I was kind of making this presentation to described at length how when one of their VPs, they had a lawsuit, and this is a global conglomerate that was recently filing for some bids for some contracts in large sports events. And the VP had some incriminating mail about kickbacks to the head of the committee that was making the decision. And the email was found in his PSD on his summer home in Switzerland. So, I mean, the IT person who had to go fly to all his summer homes and actually retrieve this data, it was a tough job. But we're going to eliminate that particular pain. So, from the personal archive perspective, the feedback we've gotten is, very well, this fulfills the information, stores the data. However, it is a completely separate infrastructure to maintain your data. And while you get all the functionality, you do have to pay for it. So you're going to pay for your personal archive. And in some cases, if you're hosting it in the cloud, you'll pay on a per storage unit. Organizational archive, similar. But my summary from these is that we want to eliminate some of these pain points. We are responsible for your end user experience with your email data and for providing you storage management. So we're making investments in E14 to eliminate or solve some of these problems. And that's what we want your feedback on. This talks about some of the features. So there are requirements that are associated with this, and in some sense, they are the inverse of the pain points. We want to give you the infinite mailbox, and we want to give you compliance capabilities on it. What is the overall goal? That if there are reasons why you are bleeding the data out of Exchange, can we give you capabilities that will allow you to keep the information within the mail store? This is the subset of features that emerge from that. Now, one thing I would like to say, there are still viable reasons why you would take the data out of Exchange. We're just trying to minimize or reduce those reasons where you're already paying for the Exchange store so you can actually leverage it. In Exchange 2010, we've developed a personal archive capability in place within the Exchange server. The notion is that you will have a PSD-like experience within Outlook and OA that can hold your PSTs and give you archive management for the end user within their existing user tools. From the IT pro perspective, it is another mailbox in the Exchange database. And I'll drill into detail on what the architecture of that looks like. There are attributes, so schema attributes within the AD, four or five of them that will represent this, and it will be an additional mailbox. Furthermore, we've provided within Outlook OA and in the IT pro management a workflow to allow you to move your data from your primary to your archive, and eventually, if your organization requires it, to delete that data. So you could imagine that all mail that a user receives within 2 years can, by an admin set policy that a user can then configure, will move the data from your primary mailbox to the archive, and then in 10 years, that data may be deleted from your archive. A third policy is the hold policy. So if we've given you the capability to move and delete the data, we also want to give the admin the capability to preserve items for recovery. So irrespective of the delete policy, whether the user deletes information, we're giving you the ability within the Exchange store to set a setting on a user that says all the changes or edits or data associated with this user will be preserved for recovery for a specific time frame. And I'm going to demo all these features, so hopefully they'll seem more real at the end of that. And finally, those first three pillars I described are all about preserving your email information and keeping it within your email store. But because this is a compliance discussion, the requirement is that whatever you preserve, whether you keep your email or delete it, there is a requirement to discover it. And so in Exchange 2010, we're providing a multi-mailbox search, a commandlet that will do a search across all the mailboxes in your enterprise, and an ECP discovery console that will allow you to search and discover information. Furthermore, we're leveraging the RBAC capability so you can delegate access to this. So you as the IT admin don't have to perform every single search. You can actually delegate this to an IT officer for permission for only the specific mailboxes that they can have access to. And finally, there's sort of the band at the bottom, which is prove. So our strategy is preserve, discover, and prove. The prove part is to provide auditing and logging requirements, reporting information around all these compliance features. And this model represents the roadmap. So we're kind of putting some features within RTM, for example, ensuring that you can log all the information about discoveries. And then post-RTM, we're going to enable detailed reporting of, say, mailbox operations, et cetera. That's something we'd like your feedback on. Okay. So a summary of the personal archive, and then I'm going to show you. I'm going to create one on the machine and then show you what it looks like from the end user perspective. As you can see from the screenshot, the archive is an alternate mailbox. It will appear in your Outlook as a separate node. Our intent here was to preserve the PSD experience. And so just like you have with PSTs today, the end users understand this paradigm. They understand this notion of separation. And when we did usability, we got feedback that, yes, preserve that for me, but allow me to search across it. One of the key pain points of having a stub solution or a third-party solution is you can't search across it. Well, because we keep the data in Exchange, there's absolutely no stubs involved, and all the data is indexed by the same content indexing service. So just like when you click all mail items in Outlook and you get Windows desktop search goes and searches all your PSTs in your mailbox within the archive, you will get the same capability, the ability to search in Outlook across your primary and your archive. There's a separate quota for the primary and the archive. You can drag and drop PSTs to it, and the archive can grow independently from the primary mailbox. These are some of the assumptions, and I'll return to this after I do the demo. So before we talk about what the actual kind of limitations or boundaries we have around the archive functionality, let me show you how it actually works. I'm going to show you some of the scenarios around this. Okay. So here we have Todd Meadows' mailbox. As you can see, there's no archive. He's got a bunch of PSTs. These names are selected by marketing, so if you don't like them, you know, blame them. I personally had wanted Captain Kirk, Riker, and Jean-Luc Picard, but we have to pay for those, so. And in these tough times, it's not going to happen. So this is Todd's mailbox just before, right, where you can see there's no archive. Todd's got his PSTs, he's got his inbox. I'm going to go in and create an archive for Todd. What would folks like me to name this archive? How it's going to show up in Todd's mailbox? Archive-ToddM? Hands for that? Yes? Todd's other store? Todd's PSTs? Okay, just archive. So that's the benefit of sitting in the front row. I can hear you. Okay. You know what? I'm going to cut and paste this. That's quicker. Todd M. Okay, so these commandlets will change slightly in the RTM version. Instead of having the new alternate mailbox capability, what we'll be calling it is new mailbox-archive. We decided that so your existing scripts don't break and you'll always have a way to do get mailbox. But this is a slightly earlier version, build 5.32, so it shows the earlier. So here we go. Thought has actually now got an archive. Now, let me close and reopen. So this is because it's an early build that you have to close and reopen. One of the cool things that we've done this work on right now, what's happening is that auto-discover is rerunning to go and get the data from AD. So all these prompts will not be there when we finally... And as you can see, here we have it. There is Todd's archive. So what's essentially what's happening on the back end is we've done some code work in auto-discover. Auto-discover goes off and discovers what are the mailboxes that the user has access to. It does this today with delegate mailboxes. What we've done is added to the auto-discover payload a new piece of information called the archive mailbox or the alternate mailbox. And so when auto-discover reruns, what it does is goes to the AD, gets the properties, gets the name that I just called that archive, and then automatically populates it in the end user's mailbox. The experience for OAuth and Outlook is the same. Because auto-discover runs on a periodic basis, you don't actually have to restart Outlook. So from the end user perspective, one day they don't have an archive, they get a mail from their IT pro telling them, you're going to get an archive, and the next time they log in or after a few minutes when auto-discover reruns, an archive will appear in their environment. Now what can I do with this archive? So the archive itself has a certain set of default folders, right? It will, by default, only have deleted items and the search folders. However, because there is a move policy that may be configured for the archive, what I describe, it gives you a timeline that actually moves the data from your primary to your archive, and I'll demo that a little bit later, there will be a separate folder hierarchy that mirrors your primary mailbox when that data is actually moved. So one of the first things we'd like to do with Todd's mail is look at some of his existing mail. You know, maybe move this information to his archive. And then I would also like to move, say, all this PST data. Move that to his archive. Just do drag and drop, move this information. Within the archive, I get all the capabilities that I do within the primary mailbox. I can flag a message, I can categorize a message. I can reply to a message. When I reply to a message, the send items appears in the primary mailbox send items because it is a new message. If I do conversation view in my primary or my archive, my conversation view will be scoped to my primary and my archive, just like the PST is today. And when I do a search, I'll be able to search across both. Finally, the best part of this entire exercise, Todd can move all his data and then close his PSTs. And he's done. This was our hope, to essentially give you an archive that would pull PST data out of the desktops, back into your online store, into your managed environment, and then allow you to eliminate or block PSTs. The roadmap by which you actually block them is entirely up to you. Cool. Any questions on that? Any? Yes, absolutely. So the question was, can you see it, Noah? Yes, you can. I think essentially that's coming in a later build. I'm not sure if folks have access to some of our builds. I think some of the audience typically do. So, yes, it is absolutely an OAuth in Exchange 14 timeframe.
Do we need a separate license?
Do you need a separate license? So the archive is associated with the Enterprise CAL license. That's the... Yes?
Is there a way
to automatically import actual PSTs out? Ah, great question. So in the roadmap... there will be a way to actually import the PSTs. Today, what we have is drag and drop. So post E14 RTM, we're going to have a tool that imports this. The reason why partly it's resourcing, right? We're entering a completely new business. There's going to be a laundry list of features that you're going to see coming out as Exchange continues to invest in this area. However, the archive vendors, our competitors, don't have any other capability to move the data to an archive. We have drag and drop. So that's why it's prioritized to do it sort of fairly close post-RTM. I think we missed you, so.
Yeah. Is it possible for the end user to delegate access to archives as they look on the mailbox?
Great question. So is it possible for end users to delegate access to the archive? So today I have an admin who actually manages my calendar. I also want them to manage my archive data. Not in the RTM timeframe, but post E14, which is the official term for our roadmap. Absolutely. That's actually, we've kind of done the architecture work for it, and we know exactly what's required. So it's the last one I'll take, and then at the end, absolutely, I'll have lots. I just want to make sure that I get some of your touch points during the presentation as well. Great question. So the archive mailbox, is it in the same message store as the mailbox, or can you actually specify? So it's a separate mailbox. When you create it, it's entirely independent. In the RTM timeframe, it will be required to be on the same database as the primary. How many folks have been to the large mailbox presentation, kind of the hot and cold store, Matt Gossage? Okay, so just to give you a quick summary. When you have a large amount of data, one of the things in E14 that we want to enable was storing your more frequently accessed data and your less frequently accessed data on very large, slow disks. The advantages of this, you get cheaper disks. You can use cheaper disks for the information, but you also get the kind of end-user experience for access that you want because only a subset of the data is accessed frequently. So if all the data was accessed frequently, you could have more users on the database, and you would actually have smaller mailboxes. But what we want is for you to have large mailboxes, large archive, and have kind of large databases, and have your archive and your primary within your same database. So in E14 RTM, you're required to have your archive and your primary on the same database. Going forward, because, and I think if folks have seen Rajesh's presentation, actually, how many folks were at Rajesh's presentation? Our VP. Okay, cool. So one of the things that came out of Rajesh's presentation is that is our kind of roadmap and our strategy going forward, that we want you to keep the archive and the primary on the same database so that you can get access to hot and cold data. However, we want to provide you flexibility. For a variety of reasons, we've gotten clear feedback that that's not something that's going to work for your environment. Either you already have a certain software deployed, either you don't want to do backups, you want a different SLA. So for that reason, shortly post E14 RTM, we'll be providing the capability to put it on a separate database as well. Great, thank you for that applause. So how many folks would deploy the archive and the primary on the same database? Could I see a show of hands, please? Great. I think I saw a few people. And how many folks would deploy the archive and primary in a separate database? Wow. Well, thank you. it's always good to get validation on your feature list. So I appreciate that. And folks who are deploying them on the same database, I think that's excellent for your environment, that you have the ability to take advantage of the hot and cold co-location, as we call it, that you're going to benefit from. And for the other folks, I think it's your choice to see if that's going to be advantageous for you or not, depending on your environment. Cool. Okay, what about compression? So I think that's going to be the last question, and then I'm going to... And by the way, there's kind of a lot of questions on essentially what is the storage of it. So when you have end-user access data frequently, your kind of distribution or your geo-distribution model is to spread out those users across many databases. At that point, compressing... So for example, I send you a mail. We both have copies of that mail. Compression is only useful if we're both on the same database. And for a variety of reasons, we may not be. Kind of IO profiles, when we've done this study, has been wildly different. Right? Microsoft is a global company. Most are. So we don't actually single instance or compress the data because we take advantage of our distributed infrastructure to give you end user access. What we found is actually storing the information once, so not duplicating the information in your primary versus some other archive, but you know, storing it all in exchange in one instance, becomes overall cheaper, even though we don't single instance or compress it. And that's actually why we made that call. Okay, great. So moving on. These are the scenarios that I essentially described in the kind of end user of what the archive looks like. And that was sort of the demo that we just went through. I'd like to spend a few minutes on the archive assumptions. And this is where I would really like your feedback. This is kind of our chance, and our first chance, to get this feature out in front of you. So your thoughts on this is very valuable. So our principles when we built this was we wanted to preserve or improve the PSD experience. We wanted to make sure that the user was kind of abstracted from regulatory requirements. So anyone who's kind of put a VP on hold and has had to deal with how annoyed that VP is because they get the series of mails and they're told, don't delete any email associated with these 20 keywords. And you know, the VP's like, I don't remember the keywords. There's no way I'm not going to delete the mail. The only real solution is to journal all the information and then maintain a completely separate copy of it. So our goal with this archive is to say that you can put users on hold, and they don't have to be impacted by that requirement. And that can hold can be for indefinite or for 2 years, 7 years. In Exchange 2010, users will have only one archive. So the reason why people created multiple PSTs was because PSTs had size limitations, right? 2 gigs and then 20 gigs, Unicode limitations, and you were in trouble. Your PST would begin to get corrupted. Well, we don't have those limitations in the mailbox, so we don't want to introduce additional nodes unless it's absolutely necessary. Furthermore, when you have the delegate scenario, you will have additional nodes. So there will be only one archive in Exchange 2010, and that's the end user experience we've chosen. The archive is online only. There are a variety of reasons why we picked to do that. First of all, we have a mechanism for online and offline. If you want something offline accessible, it is in your primary mailbox, and you should keep it in your primary mailbox. What we didn't want to do, point one, was to place on the user the additional burden of determining whether a piece of email should be online and or offline, in addition to determining whether something should be in your primary archive. There's just one decision point for them. Is it in my primary or my archive? And it's available offline if it's in my primary. The second thing is the archive is going to grow indefinitely to 20 or 30 gigs. So caches, Outlook caches typically, the OST gets rebuilt about once every 2 weeks, once every week. For most branch office environments, that is an enormous load. And as the volume of data grows, you're going to be placing that kind of load on your CAS servers and on your mailbox servers. And that's actually something not desirable. One reason why we built the archive is we want to be able to scale indefinitely and make it online only. The third assertion we're making is that our hope is that as the world becomes more connected, the environment where you'll be able to have to access something in your archive, and that the only time you need to access it is while you're offline, we're hoping that is actually a rare scenario. That's kind of the assertion. You will always be able to search across both, and once you do a search, you can pull that data into your primary and preserve that for your offline scenarios. Number five, the workflow that I talked about that I will demo. Mail folders will automatically be moved from your primary to your archive. So the admin can set a policy on your entire mailbox that will move the data from the primary to the archive. And delete policies will be global. So you can apply a delete policy within your primary or your archive, and that policy applies to the message irrespective of where it lives. So one of the pieces of feedback from third-party vendors, and kind of if you compare this to the third-party archiving experience, is that there is no synergy between the primary and the archive. And there can't be. I think our partners do an excellent job given the constraints of their problem space. But there is no way for them to say this policy that applies in my primary content will also apply to my archive because that UI is not shared. Or if that UI is shared, it's based on syncing and moving data. So the schema is always specific to one or the other. It's not shared as it is with the primary and the archive. And finally, when you set a policy, and I'm going to talk in detail about message retention, the longest time for that policy wins. So for example, if you choose to delete an email in 1 year and you apply a folder policy to delete it in 3 years, 3 years will win. But before I kind of delve into what is a folder policy, what is an item policy, I'll talk more about the IT Pro experience for archive and drill into that in subsequent slides. Okay, so this was just click-throughs for just in case the demo gods did not favor us. But we were lucky today. Setting up Todd's mailbox worked well. So equivalent to the end user assumptions, we have a bunch of IT Pro assumptions. You have to have a primary mailbox to have an archive. And you have to have an AD user account in Exchange 2010 to have the archive. We want to preserve the management experience across both. So one of the pieces of feedback we got was, it's great that we have these third-party archives, but we can't actually, we have to manage them completely independently and have a separate OPEX and CAPEX infrastructure. But what we wanted to do is all the tools you have to manage your primary mailbox and your mailbox management experience, they will apply to the archive. And there can only be one archive per user. Okay, so somebody had a question about what are the schema properties that we added for the archive. So the reason I have that really busy slide is to show you Exchange has not exactly been stingy in adding properties to the schema for the user account. We're generous. You know, we were the number one application for AD, and so we decided, you know, we pretty much own the AD schema, so let's add what we want. It's a little bit of internal history for you. However, when we created the archive, one of our goals was We want to minimize any kind of muddiness that we add to the schema. So really, there are four main properties that we add to the schema. The archive GUID, which identifies it. The archive name, which you saw me type in when I asked for suggestions on what that archive should be called. The archive database and the archive quota. So the archive database in RTM is always the same as a primary mailbox database. But to answer your question, post E14 RTM, based on the requirement and the need and the feedback that we hear, it will be an alternate database. Additionally, you've got a couple of others like the database link and the database GUID, which are just supporting attributes for that. But that's it. That is what you will see in AD on the user account to indicate that you have an archive. The scenarios, we add the archive, we remove the archive. Just sort of moving through these fairly quickly. So this is the command shell experience that I showed you was with an alternate mailbox. We got a lot of feedback from IT pros that they prefer the new mailbox paradigm. So I'll show you what the commandlets will be in the RTM timeframe. In the EMC experience, adding the archive to a mailbox will just be a click on the existing user account. So when you have your new mailbox wizard, you can just add an archive to that user as part of that experience. Or you can go back and set properties on that user to enable an archive. All the existing paradigms of enabling an archive can work through new, enable, or connect the archive. So all those three that work for the existing mailbox work for the archive. The only difference that you'll actually see is that because an archive requires a primary mailbox, when you run, say, new, enable, or connect, or you try to remove it, if there is no primary mailbox or new associated with that user, you'll get an error. You have to create a primary mailbox first. You pass in a single new parameter and specify the username, specify the name for the archive, and that's it. The archive auto discover flow. So this, as I described, was Outlook receives the archive properties, what it should be called. There's four properties that we saw in AD through auto discover, and eventually what you'll get is a new node that will appear the next time auto discover refreshes. Unlike my demo, which is on early bits, it does not require an Outlook restart. So for how many folks is kind of the Outlook restart, the fact that we don't require an Outlook restart, how I'd like to see kind of a show of hands. Is that really good? Show of hands? Or okay? It's like fine. Okay, wow. It's kind of a few more for really good, so that's disabling and disconnecting the archive, as I mentioned. You can disable just the archive, enable just the archive. Your only prerequisite is that you have to have a primary mailbox. All the existing commandlets for remove, disable, etc. So the reason I'm sort of walking through these is IT pros, one of the clear pieces of feedback they gave us was, okay, we have email. Email volume keeps growing. We have this entire management infrastructure to manage it in the primary mailbox, and we have all these existing PowerShell commandlet tools that we manage. None of them apply to email that's not within the mailbox. Well, if you decide to put your data, your archive data and your PST data that's traditionally outside within your Exchange mailbox, all the existing management infrastructure will now apply. Get set archive GUI, and that's a case where you can actually set the archive quota. So the archive quota is independent from the primary mailbox. You can actually potentially set archive quota to be, say, 20 gigs and set the primary mailbox quota to be 2 or 10. So I'm actually curious. From the folks in the audience, what is the average mailbox size? So can I see a show of hands for folks for whom the average mailbox size is 1 gig or less? Okay, great. Good to know. Show of hands for folks whom average mailbox size is between 1 and 5, greater than 1, less than 5. Okay, cool. Okay, and just show of hands for folks where it's greater than 5. Cool. Microsoft folks, you're not allowed. It's like... So we dog food, so we get infinite mailboxes if we want. On the downside, we get dog food issues. So we get to play around with this, all 400 of us, before it ever gets out to anyone else. So. In fact, does anyone know why dog food is called dog food? Yeah, that's right, because I think one of our old VPs, I think he's no longer with the company, but he said, you know, we as a company, when we have software, we have to eat our own dog food. We can't, like, sell this dog food to other people if we don't eat it. It's a really, you know, great image, but from a procedural perspective, it's actually helped us enormously. Okay, get set archive. So all the get set mailbox statistics, getting information about the archive, All you do is you add dash archive and you get that information. If you want to get mailbox statistics for a database, you'll get the information about both the primary and the archive, or you'll get information about just the archive by specifying the dash archive flag. Okay, migration. So any questions before I move to migration? Can I get a touch point? Yeah, actually, let me get that. Yep. Ah, great question. So when you delete the user's mailbox, or when you get rid of it, does it delete the archive? So today when you delete a mailbox, it's sort of left on the database, and then later on when the memory is being reclaimed, it'll get garbage collected. The same thing will happen with the archive, yes.
Will the auto-discover where it automatically opens the archive, will that work with Outlook 2007?
Ah, great. Not the easy question. So the question was, will it work with 2007? What do I get with... So currently... In E14 RTM, it's kind of only E14. Can I get, and I know this is like, this is the question where you know the answer, but you ask it anyway. How many folks would deploy the archive within, you know, say within in the E14 SP1 timeframe? That's 2011 or 2012. So would you deploy the archive in 2012 only if you had 2007 support? So I'm going out a few years. Let me put it another way. If you only had 014, would you deploy the archive in 2012? How many folks would deploy the archive with only 014 in 2012? Wow, not everyone at once, please. But yeah, I saw a couple of like maybe three or four folks, but fair enough. So I think, and then I'll ask the question, how many folks won 2007, the archive? Okay, great. Okay. So I also spend a little bit more time on that. And just to give you some context, enabling 2007 on the archive architecturally, we're using the delegate mailbox paradigm. So enabling 2007 on the mailbox would be kind of similar to that. You would get the separate node experience. You would not, however, get any of the move policy experience. And so one of the things we're looking at is it this kind of reduced experience that we provide. Is it better to provide this reduced experience and give you a sense, give you access to the archive? Or should we actually just give you the entire whole experience with 014? Now, I know most of you are actually on Outlook 2003, so this kind of seems like a moot question. And so apologies for that. We're sort of, you know, a few years ahead. But kind of if 2007 is kind of a deal breaker for you, and we won't be doing it below 2007, I would really like to see emails so I can actually collate them and we'll make the case. Absolutely. So thank you for that. So it is in OWA. So in OWA, we think of it as OWA 14. So even if you don't have an Outlook 2007, you will have all the functionality that I've shown in OWA. Ah, so the that huge number of folks, so yeah. So I think, to be fair, so all the properties and the object extensions that we've are available through IMAP. So one of our, you know, we have, for example, third-party clients like our Office for Macs client that are building an experience around this using the web service, so not typically IMAP, but you could imagine that any vendor could build an experience using this. Those properties will still be supported. I think the kind of more serious long-term question is, how long is, you know, MAPI support going to be around, right? And for the foreseeable future, it is. It's going to be a bit like public folders. It's never going to go away until the last user's gone, so let's see. Okay, so migration of the archive. So in 2010, we will have migration of the archive and the primary and the archive together. That's because they're going to be on the same database. So the notion is that you will create a move request. So are folks familiar with our online move work, where essentially you get you have access to your mailbox until the very short, you know, 5-minute failover or few second failover from your old mailbox to your new mailbox. So all that migration work that we've done will apply over here. So when you move your primary or you move your primary and your archive, you will get the online move mailbox experience. And the workflow is kind of as I described. The move request will be initiated. The data will be moved. The user will still have access to their old mailbox. Once the move is complete, Outlook will do, the attributes will be updated, and the new CAS server on the target database will be updated. And Outlook will reconnect using AutoDiscover to the new CAS server and get access to the new mailbox. In this case, it will be the seamless failover from your access to primary and archive in your old database to primary and archive on your target database. These are some of the scenarios for load balancing. Move will work the same. And now I'm going to talk about move and delete policy. So all the things I talked about, message retention. I think so far, to summarize, we have your IT pro experience and your end user experience for the archive. What is the workflow between the two? So we have three policies that we're introducing in Exchange 2010. The first is the archive or move policy. The archive policy moves data from your primary to your archive based on a specific time frame. The continuum is that admins can set a policy on the primary mailbox and not allow users to change it at all, or they can set a policy on the primary and give the user certain personal policies that they can use to set exceptions. I'll show a demo of what that actually visually looks like. How many folks are actually familiar with managed folders? Okay, great. So then I will state this in the context of managed folders. Delete policy allows you to set a policy of deletion on your primary mailbox. Now, in managed folders, the notion was that you got these folders that came down from the admin, appeared in your inbox, and there was an automatic delete policy on your primary mailbox. And if you wanted to keep data, you had to move them to the appropriate managed folder for the appropriate time frame. We got enormous feedback that this was the, I think, what was one of our MVP said, the worst end user feature you've ever released. So I thought that was a little harsh, personally, but having played with managed folders and dog food, it was within the bounds of reason. And really, the primary criticism was that you have this managed folder infrastructure. It's not my folder hierarchy, and what if I don't move data into folders? You're changing my entire workflow. So the delete policy in Exchange 2010 is the policy will be applied on the mailbox and on the existing system folders, like inbox, send items, and deleted items, same as managed folders. However, you will also get the ability to apply a policy that the user can then set on folders within their mailbox. Furthermore, while you can set this policy on a folder, so I create a folder, Project X, I can set a policy on it, you can also set a policy on an item. So if I have data in my inbox that gets deleted in a year, I can set exceptions to messages on that, or I can set an exception by moving it to another folder called Project X and applying that policy. The third policy of interest is hold policy. So we have all this workflow that will move and delete data within the system. Hold policy is an admin setting that determines how long messages will be preserved for recovery. And what we've done in E14 is we've actually made the dumpster searchable and indexable. So you can actually keep information in there and preserve it. We'll do a demo on that subsequently, but first I would like to show you a demo of the message retention policy. Okay, great. So here we are. We're in Todd's mailbox again, and you have this drop-down here for retention policy. So this drop-down is the set of personal policy tags that an admin deploys to an end user. These are the ones that the end user can use to set to a folder or an item. Furthermore, every item in Todd's inbox has a default policy, and you can see it over here. So one of the pieces of feedback we got about managed folders was my mail gets deleted, and I don't know when it's going to get deleted. I have no idea what the process is. It's existential email despair. There's no notion. My email disappears. It's mission critical. So one of the first things that we did with the Outlook team was give you a date in your info bar. That will, in OAuth and Outlook, tell you when an email is going to be deleted. You know. Furthermore, your search folders, you can actually create a search folder that says, show me mail that's expiring soon. And you'll be able to see all the email that's going to get deleted within a certain period of time. So here I'm going to take one of these folders, go to Properties, and apply a folder-based policy on this. So let's say I do great. And now I've got mail in my inbox that is got my inbox default. I'm going to drag that mail in here, and I can now see that the act of dragging that mail changed the retention policy on that message to whatever the retention policy is on that folder. Now, if I'm the kind of person who doesn't file messages, now, personally, as email volume grows, the ability to actually keep track of your mail and file messages becomes harder and harder. So are folks familiar with the term pilers and filers? Okay, so pilers are people who don't file their mail, right? It just grows. It's, you know, those are the people who, when they come home, and you'll know there'll be a stack of envelopes right next to their door. Filers are people who actually move their messages into appropriate folder hierarchies. Most of us fall in the middle. When we go on vacation or come back from vacation, we're all pilers to some degree. So how many pilers in the audience? See a show of hands? Okay, cool. How many filers? Okay, cool. So the kind of this notion came out of when we were demoing this feature within the team. Our GM and our VP are notorious pilers. It's because they just can't keep up with their email inflow. And so we had to make sure this is the item level policy is for those folks. So pilers, you're in good company. The additional thing you can do is actually on an individual message, apply a retention policy to it. And as you can see, immediately, so if you are a piler who doesn't want to move their messages, you can apply the retention policy on that individual messages, on that individual message and get it to be changed. Furthermore, your default policy on your inbox can be set per item type. So as you saw, there was a retention policy expiry for messages in your inbox, but there's nothing on voicemail. It's because you basically want to delete all your voicemail. You want to delete all your regular mail and have a policy on it, but you don't want voicemail in the inbox to be deleted. So you can apply item type policy. So that's it for the retention policy. Okay, just walking through, these are the screenshots. Just a quick look at what would be the message flow. I described this briefly. The notion here is that the initial message flow is a message comes into your inbox, you apply a move policy to it, and it's moved to the archive after X years. So one thing, by the way, that I didn't show was the move policy. The entire experience there is exactly the same. What you get is instead of seeing expires after 5 years, you'll see moves. And the folder policy is appropriately the same end user experience. So if kind of walking through this flow, and I kind of put these in case our demo didn't work, just to kind of show you the entire end-to-end flow, which is you move messages to a particular folder, you can apply a move policy to that folder so that all messages in your mailbox are moved after 5 years, but everything in that folder is, say, moved after 10. For deletion, you can do the same. You can have a DL, like the Hello Lunch DL, where mail gets deleted really quickly, and when it moves to the archive, automatically, you can have a different policy within the archive to get mail deleted after, say, 15 years. You can apply that policy to a specific message so that whether it's kept in your primary or your archive is determined by the policy you apply on that message, and when it gets deleted is also determined by the user-selected policy. If you are the kind of organization where you don't actually want to allow users to select policy, you can apply an admin policy and no personal policy tags, which you could see in the dropdown. And just to show you the move policy experience that wasn't in this build, just like you saw the retention policy experience, on top of the Outlook archive properties, you will have a move policy experience identical that you can use to apply to a folder properties. And that's really the screenshot up there. This will be available in both Outlook and OWA. As you can see, that's the Outlook experience and that's the OWA experience. So it's running on my mailbox. And if we had internet access, I would show you my my mailbox with this policy applied on it. Okay, great. Any thoughts on that before we move on to hold and discover? Yeah.
And it would be great to be able to take that classification of the email and just be able to pull it out of Exchange. So once a project closes, it's just gone.
Yeah, that's actually a great question. So my gentleman's question was, this is pretty close to a records management system, dangerously close. So couldn't we just actually have something associated with a project? So I think the classic feedback we've gotten on this feature is there are two scenarios for it. One is the quota management scenario, where I, as an end user, get mail from a particular DL. We have a DL at Microsoft called Investor's Alias. And it gets used for many things besides investment. And anyone who has time on their hands or has had a bad day, you know, goes and rants about the state of the economy. So it's kind of that's the nature of the DL. And sometimes you get good investment tips. But I don't really want to keep mail from that DL longer than a specific period of time. So for that scenario, I would use it as a quota management tool and say delete all mail within 5 years. Sorry, delete all mail within 5 months. Yeah, there might be something useful in 5 months, but beyond that now. However, the second scenario that we frequently get talked about is a regulatory scenario, where there is a project, say acquisitions, as you saw there, or mergers, and you want to actually associate information with that project. So in E14 RTM, you will have the capability to say, I can apply a policy, as you saw over there, from the end user perspective, to say acquisitions to any folder or any. And that the action that results from that can be, it gets deleted, it gets moved to the archive. The third action, which will be coming post E14 RTM, is it can be journaled to another location. And that is really the scenario you're talking about. I think the one more addendum to that scenario is it would be great if I could run a transport rule that says any email with this keyword can actually have this policy automatically applied to it. Also something we're doing post E14 RTM. Absolutely. So the manual tagging, E14 RTM, you got it. Absolutely. So the manual tagging is all there. The admin can actually set the transport rules tagging, where if you don't trust the user, that would come later. Cool. Thank you. Yep. Let me take one from this side. Sorry about folks on this end. Yep. Absolutely. Actually, so great question. So the question is, how do I combine move and delete policies? So one of the feedback we get is that our UI is fairly busy. If you've seen some of our major webmail competitors, their UI isn't as busy, and I think that's really valid feedback. So we actually didn't want to add additional data. So the only thing you will see as a notification in the UI is when the mail will get deleted. When it will get moved is sort of implicit, and you just apply the policy. However, if you do a search for the item or you try to find all related items, that message will automatically be found. So you will get that capability. Post E14 RTM, the one thing I'd want feedback on is we're going to look at, can we do some sort of conversation view, where by default you don't get the messages, but you actually get a view across both. But so by and the way that the two policies actually get applied is if you delete the item first, it won't get moved. If you move the item and then delete it, then the delete gets to apply. Okay, cool. So moving on to hold policy. And I will spend some time on questions at the end. Oops. Okay, great. So this is just showing screenshots. I wanted to have folks to have kind of the background on what it's going to look like in Outlook and OWASP. So your feedback on that, you know, would be great. Okay, hold policy. So one of the key things or requirements of an archive is I put this data in my archive, it's my lockbox. I don't want any changes to it. I want to be able to say that a particular user, whatever data they apply or change in the archive, is preserved. So what we've introduced is the notion of hold policy or legal hold or retention hold, however you'd like to call it, in Exchange. What this does is it's a setting on a user account that defines for what period of time any edits or deletes or changes to their content will be preserved and discoverable in their mailbox. The user workflow associated with this is there's no impact on them. So how many folks are familiar with kind of the dumpster recoverable items feature? So great. Okay. I'm curious, how many folks have users who actually get items out of the recoverable items feature in Outlook on a regular basis? Like how popular is it? Okay, great. Okay, that's actually quite a... So our workflow kind of overloads this recoverable items workflow. The notion is the user has mail in their inbox. They apply a move or a delete policy to it, or they actually delete the email. So here, I'm going to use this. So in Exchange 2007, what happened? The user deleted a message. It went to their deleted items. If they deleted from their deleted items, it went to their dumpster. If they kind of removed it from their dumpster, it got purged. This is the behavior in 2007. What we've given you is a hold policy on this entire workflow in 2010. The hold policy says the user's workflow is the same. There's a policy, or I delete an item, goes to deleted items. If I remove it from the deleted items, it goes to the recoverable items. Now when I purge it from the recoverable items, I cannot actually eliminate the information from the system, I as the end user, unless the admin policy period or hold length is actually longer. So if the admin sets, you'd imagine the admin would set a hold policy on the user's mailbox of, say, 30 days. That means when a user edits or deletes a mail, all copies are moved to their dumpster, and they are preserved there. If a user tries to eliminate the information, it will disappear from their view, but it will be preserved for discovery or for actual access by the admin within the hidden folders in the dumpster that they don't have access to. Two scenarios that actually become useful for this. Number one, single item recovery. So if I delete something by accident, today folks keep backups around for 30-day timeframes because if the user deletes it and purges their dumpster and then needs to get the item back, it's gone unless you go to a backup. Well, here, it's gone from the user's view, but the policy applied by the enterprise applies, and you'll be able to get back that item for 30 days or whatever time period you apply on the dumpster. The second scenario for this is the legal hold scenario. You don't want the user to be able to edit or delete any information from their mailbox for, say, 2 years or 7 years or whatever the duration is associated with that, for example, with a financial case or records. You then apply a hold policy of 7 years, and that information is preserved in the dumpster. The dumpster does not count towards the user's quota, kind of separate data information, and there will be a move policy that will move information from the primary mailbox dumpster to the archive dumpster so that if you want the archive to be the repository for all this information, you can enable that as well. Yes, please.
What about POP users that pop all their mail down into the inbox and they want to do a recovery because
they're not going to go down? Yeah, so excellent question. So what about POP users? So the interesting thing about this hold policy is that it applies irrespective of what the mechanism is used to delete the mail. So if you have put hold policy on the user's mailbox, even if an admin logs into that user's mailbox, so an admin logs into my mailbox and I'm on hold, they try to delete that information, it will still be preserved. The only way to remove information from the system is to actually take the user off of hold. And we will log that. So you will be able to audit information to say that if the user is on hold and if the user is removed from hold, it will be audited. And once that setting is in place, whatever the mechanism to access the data, deletion cannot be done.
Will the user be able to restore their own mailbox, the inbox part of it?
Great question. So the question is, can the user actually do the single item recovery themselves? So by the way, the first question was, what about POP users? This existing infrastructure to do, you know, recoverable deleted items within Outlook will work, and we're going to also enable that in OWA. So the user will absolutely be able to do what they do. However, if they purge that information, then the admin may need to step in. That's a very rare case. So. Yep, cool. Sorry, can I take one over there? And by the way, at the end, absolutely, I'll be here for as long as... So, that gentleman over there.
If you have a legal hold in place or a document retention policy, what happens if the user gets their account
deleted? So the... It's a sort of good question. So what if other fail-safe measures fail? I have the user's mailbox, and their account is actually, their mailbox is actually deleted. I think what you just mentioned is a bug I'm going to file when I go back to not allow a mailbox to be deleted if it's on hold. So I think, yeah, absolutely. So I'm being humorous, but in a nutshell, so this is not the only case. So there are a couple of things we actually block. If the user's on legal hold, if an admin actually tries to go and apply a expiry policy on the dumpster to actually delete information from the dumpster, we forbid that. If the user tries to disable the archive, we actually, you know, prevent that. If the user account is deleted, it's kind of outside the Exchange infrastructure, so you can't actually go and check. It happens, you know, it'll happen in the AD MMC. But what we can do is ensure that that mailbox is not scheduled for garbage collection, and that's basically what we would do. Okay, great. Okay, I'll take one more and then I'm going to kind of, yep. Yes, absolutely. So what is the edit experience? So the edit experience here is the user goes in, they edit a message. In their experience, it's as it is today. So they'll see the edited message. It's just like that. The message that is the old message or the original message is actually preserved in the dumpster. So if you do a discovery, both will pop up. Okay, great. I want to make sure I get to show a demo of hold policy. This is the command line experience and the user experience. And just one last thing, I won't spend a lot of time on this, but I'll stay for questions later, is existing mechanisms for journaling within the archive or to move data out of the mailbox will still be possible. We're not eliminating them or stopping support of them. We'd like you to keep the data within the mailbox if you're archiving it, but absolutely, these capabilities, for whatever the reason why you need to do this, will still be possible. And we'd also want you to enable potentially to journal data to another mailbox. So if for some reason you just want to journal a user but not give them an archive, that will be possible. Great. So discovery, and in fact, I'm just going to demo this so you can get a look at, I think some folks have already probably seen this in the Rajesh did a demo of our discovery experience. This is currently running within the Microsoft environment. We're just waiting for litigation so we can kind of practice it. Yes, that is not an invitation by any means. Okay. So kind of one of the first things, kind of going back to the scenario that we have Todd. Todd is involved in some shady business. Okay? So he essentially happens to run, he's running a company, and he kind of gets involved in some acquisitions. He actually tries to kind of get something kind of in a sort of questionable way. And one of the things, the moment the acquisition falls into place, is that the admins of that environment, they put everyone who's associated with that, in this particular case, particularly Todd, they put him on legal hold. So, and I've got the command up there so you can... So one thing to note in mind over here is right now we are overloading the 2010. For those folks of you who have actually used this prior in Exchange 2007, in this particular demo, I am overloading the Exchange 2007 retention hold enabled commandlet. We will not be doing that. When we ship, we will actually be using the commandlet that I showed you Okay, great. Okay, and you're looking at me restarting the RPC service and the store service. Will not be required when we ship. Just be very clear. We did all this work, but there's this one fatal flaw. You have to restart Jet, every time. So, actually, Jet was the first team I worked on when I joined Microsoft, and then. I was in the Active Directory team, and Jet moved to Exchange, and I moved to Exchange. And kind of the story is that once you work with Jet, you never leave. Jet's one of the... So. Okay. So we've turned on retention hold on this particular user. And here I am in Todd's mailbox. Now, Todd, in the interim, has done something kind of stupid. Prior to actually being turned on retention hold, he sent the incriminating mail I mentioned, because Todd is a smart business guy but doesn't know much about how email works. So he thinks, hey, what? It's completely confidential. He hasn't been reading the news and e-discovery laws. So he asks his report, Elizabeta, to also another name provided by marketing. So really, I think Janardhan, come on, is easier. So he asks his report essentially to do something like buy extra shares, right? This is kind of classic scenario. We've seen this happen. In fact, the PST that was found in the summer home was something very similar to this. It was, here's a little kickback if you'll give us some. So Todd goes in and goes, oh my God, let me find all the emails where I've done this, stuff that might look questionable. And the moment kind of the investigation comes, he deletes the email. He's like, okay, great. And he goes to his deleted items and says, okay, I'm going to delete it from here as well. Great. And what he does is he purges it from the dumpster. The current Outlook UI to purge it from the dumpster is kind of permanently deleted at this point, Shift-Delete. So it's gone from his environment. Todd's relieved. He's like, okay, great. This looks good. It looks like I didn't respond. I'll say I'll have a verbal conversation with her. We're all set. Meanwhile, an e-discovery request does come. Something associated with Tailspin does come to light, and there is now a need to run a discovery request on the mailboxes of everyone associated with this. Great. So Arlene is the name of our discovery officer who actually runs all this information. Now, one of the cool things about the discovery manager, and we talked about this, is the role-based access control and exchange means that the average user can actually go and perform this discovery. You can delegate to a legal officer the ability to search, say, X mailboxes. So legal can maybe search the mailboxes of legal and financial. And the IT admin can delegate this so they can lock it down, but they don't actually have to perform the search themselves. And this is typically considered legally better because sometimes everyone who was involved in the search is subpoenaed. So you can imagine the operator who manages the, say, the Beijing office or the Beijing data center required to come in because they provided this information. So not viable. So Arlene Huff is our delegated discovery officer. Furthermore, we've integrated the discovery management console experience into ECP, or the new exchange control panel. So what you previously saw as the options page in OA will now take you to the ECP page. So Arlene selects here. This is kind of her options information as you would normally see. But because Arlene has been delegated access by the IT pro, she now has access to a reporting tab and the multi-mailbox search tab. So she goes in here. She decides to create a new search. So that was the name of the company that was associated with the acquisition. And so Darlene says, I want to find all mail associated with this. I want to find, and you know what? I won't select these because Darlene actually wants to search all the mail. She wants to find any message sent in this regard. She wants to, there's no particular time frame because really they didn't discuss tailspin before the merger. And if they did, then she wants to know about it. And she wants to know which mailboxes to search. So she decides to search two DLs. The financial DL, because these were the people associated with this. And the legal DL. So here's the second advantage. You can give Arlene access to these two DLs and no access to no more to these particular groups. And you can leverage the existing DL infrastructure that already exists to determine who you want to search. Okay, so these are the two DLs that are searched. Now Arlene has to determine where does she want the search results to be stored and what does she want to call the search name. So any suggestions on the search name? No? Was that James?
Jail.
Oh, that's good. I like that one. Thank you. James, not nearly as cool. And what mailbox should we put the search results in? So Arlene, for our particular scenario, I'm going to choose to put them in Arlene's mailbox because, say, she's a legal officer and the person who has access to this. Typically, the scenario that we're going to enable is there will be a bunch of discovery mailboxes created for this environment, and Arlene will get a drop-down list that she can select from them. And part of enabling the discovery role is we will pre-create these discovery mailboxes for you. So you can imagine a scenario where you create a discovery server and have all discovery data associated with that, and you don't have to give legal officers access to any other data in your infrastructure. Okay, so I'm choosing to put it in here. Save. Great, there's one more thing I'm going to do, which you would not have to do. We know that Todd deleted all that information. However, by default, in this particular build, we don't include the dumpster in the search. When we actually ship, the dumpster will automatically be included in every search, and there will be a checkbox in the ECP UI. So you can either search just the user's primary mailbox information, or you can just search the dumpster. And both, sorry. By default, you can search both, and you can search just the primary mailbox. That's kind of, you don't get to search just the. Okay, so I've included this. Now let's go back here. And let's go look at, still running. Let's go look at Arlene's mail. And look, a folder has been created in Arlene's mailbox. And If you'd imagine in the Discovery mailbox, a similar folder would be created. And in Arlene's mailbox is every single user, the date and the date on which the search was run, where the keyword tailspin was found. Within Todd Meadows' mailbox, some things were found inside Contoso Confidential. You know, nothing too worrisome. This is kind of expected stuff. And because this is all within the Exchange infrastructure, you get to see this in conversation view. A minor advantage for the discovery officer. You get some stuff from the inbox, and every folder in which the result was found is actually enumerated. So you also know the folder infrastructure. So, and this is a true story. The person whose data was found in the PSD in Switzerland, they named their folder Kickback. And this person was actually CTO, I think. I'm wondering. I, you know, we're not buying stock from there, that's for sure. So. Now, this is the data that Todd had actually purged from his mailbox. He thought it wasn't there anymore. So in Exchange 14, we are calling the recoverable items folder is essentially the dumpster, kind of the better name for it. And Todd has now removed any evidence, he thought, of that mail from his mailbox. However, in the recoverable items folder, under deletions, this is the hidden folder because he actually removed the information. The mail that he deleted is still there. So when Arlene does the search, she finds the smoking gun. If Todd had edited the mail, it would be in here. If he had changed the mail to say something that sounded sort of less incriminating, it would be in here. And Todd goes to jail. Kind of a happy story, isn't it? It's like, it's great. So that is our Holden discovery story, and I am right on time. So kind of finishing up with the discovery demo that you've already seen. Oh, God, sorry, excuse me. Rewinding. I want to spend the last couple of minutes, and I will be here for questions. On the archive summary. So in Exchange 2007, we gave you managed folders and export mailbox for discovery. We had good intentions. In Exchange 14 RTM, all the stuff you've seen. Kind of giving you an end user archive mailbox in Outlook and OWA, give you an IT pro management experience to manage that archive within the existing Exchange infrastructure, provided a new message retention policy that you've seen to move and expire information from your primary and your archive, a hold policy that allows you, the admin, to determine how long items are preserved for discovery, and finally, a discovery capability, both GUI and command line, multi-mailbox search, to locate any information in your enterprise. Now, archiving is an area that we as Exchange are planning to invest in going forward. I mean, this has been a lot of work from my team and kind of our entire sort of 15 to 20-person dev team. But it's nowhere near done. There's a lot of work that we need to do that we're still looking at. And some of those first things that we're looking at that I've mentioned during the course of the presentation is an automatic PSD import tool, so something that will scan your environment and suck the data in, and archive in the cloud, so the ability to host the data on a separate database or host it in the cloud, so you can put just your archive in the cloud, and some additional auditing, et cetera, features. It's a long list, but that's what we've got for you, and all your feedback would be greatly appreciated. Thank you.